So, hello everyone. I am going to talk about Open Event API. As has been already covered by Mario, Niranjan and Saptak, that Open Event is a very large project. It has lots of components: the Android app, the web app, the Android app generator, and we have the Open Event management server, the event management server. So I did the API part as a part of GSOC project last year, so I am going to be talking about that. Before starting the presentation, let me give you a brief background about me. So I am a third year computer science undergrad from IIIT Vadodara, India. I have been doing software development since 2013. Actually, that time I was on Windows platform, so there was a scripting language called AutoHotkey that I learned. And just after learning, like 20 days after starting to learn that language, I did my first big project, which was a bot reader for Counter-Strike. Like, who plays Counter-Strike here? Yeah, so if you play the multiplayer mode, then you have an option to play against bots. So you can play locally with bots. So this bot reader, what it did was, it allowed you to edit bot profiles. So after that, after I think 2 months from that, I developed another clipboard manager software called ClipJump, which I continued developing for 3+ years. Like, I left it in 2016 when I switched to Linux, because AutoHotkey is only available on Windows. So meanwhile, I also developed a lot of AutoHotkey libraries and scripts. So I would like to give my thanks to the AutoHotkey community, because it brought out the developer in me. If there would have been no AutoHotkey, I wouldn't have started coding. So thank you, AutoHotkey. And I also started to do some competitive programming by 2014 on CourseF on HackerRank. So before 2014, I only knew AutoHotkey, and as you know, it is on Windows, and Windows, like, open source users, like, don't love Windows a lot. So GSOC has no place for Windows AutoHotkey. Therefore, I wasn't able to participate in GSOC 2015. So I started to learn Python by 2015, and by 2016, I was confident enough to, like, crack GSOC under FOSSASIA. GSOC 2016 was a very memorable period of my life. Very memorable period of my life. And after that, I actually mentored young students under Google Coding. So that too was a great experience. Like, being able to boss other people around is a great experience. So after that, right now I am working at a contract developer at AppBase.io. It's a company that deals with Elasticsearch clusters, and it provides a real-time data API to work with Elasticsearch. So about my strengths, about my skills, I mainly do backend development, and I also have an nano degree in Android, which was sponsored by Google. And I like scripting, I like web scraping. So my journey with FOSSASIA started through GSOC 16. So I was actually looking at the organizations list, and there was this huge list of organizations, big names like Drupal, Joomla, PSF, CodeOS. So I was, like, very scared. But then I saw FOSSASIA, and there was Asia written in it. So I thought like, they will have some reservation for Asians. So I looked into it, and I saw that Open Event Auger Server project. It was in Python, Flask. I knew a bit about it, so I tried to understand the code base, and I was able to, like, figure it out and contribute to it. So I got selected in FOSSASIA and did successfully qualified GSOC 2016. The great thing about FOSSASIA, I think, is that it has a very friendly and open community. Like, anyone who wants to be a part of it can be a part of it. There are a lot of other organizations, like, I won't take the name, but they have a huge set of rules to actually be a part of them. You have to be, like, what do you say, vouched by someone else to become a part of that. So those type of things don't exist in FOSSASIA. If you want to be a part of FOSSASIA, you can just open an issue or directly talk to the head, let's Mario, and he will add you to the team. So back to the topic, what is Open Event project? So I will give a very brief overview on the Open Event project. Like, tech events and conferences are very important for the developer community. When you come to a tech event or a conference, you get to know other people, you get to learn about new technologies, trending technologies, and you can enhance your network. So these type of things, if you're working alone or if you're working in a limited company, you won't be able to access these things. So this is the importance for that tech conferences. So right now, if you look at the tools that are available to manage tech conferences or in general conferences and events, then we have Eventbrite, Meetup, those type of things. And these things are proprietary, they are not open source, they are not hackable, they are not customizable. So we actually needed a very good, we needed a good versatile tool to manage the type, these type of events. I think like Mario had the idea in 2015 or 2014 maybe. And so we started the project Open Event. So I'm going to speak about Open Event API. So yeah, what's an API? So API is a way for apps to interact with a server. Like you have a server running at some place remote in West region USA. So you have an app here and you want the app to fetch data from the server. So API provides a language. API is like a language in which a server talks to the user. So as you know that every language has a fixed syntax, you can't just speak anything in a language. So same API has a fixed syntax. The server and the user both knows that language, and when they want to talk to each other, they use that language. So here's a diagram that shows how API, here's a, like a flowchart showing how the API works. So at the left side you will see we have the application data model, which is actually the server part, and it will show how the data is stored in the database. So API provides an interface to access that data. So here if you see, you have that entry point, inside entry point you have collection, inside collection you have resource. So it's like a hierarchy level. So entry point could be like /API, then collection could be /events, and resource could be /tickets. So inside API you have event, inside event you have tickets. So this is how it goes. And the client actually uses an HTTP library, or maybe if it's like sophisticated, it will use a REST library to access the API. So, and the data that flows between the API, between the server and the client, actually follows some schema here. Here is the sample, very limited schema showing how an API response looks like. As you may know, this is in JSON format. So, the data is, you can see that the first value success is true, which can be used as a way to tell that everything that worked, the process under the API was successful. Then we have the data packet, which shows the different type of data API returned, and we have the error set as null, means that there was no error in processing the request. So API has other concepts like status codes. So what is status codes is that, like, suppose API can return different type of error, different type of messages. So suppose the request was successful, it will return a different message. And suppose if request failed, suppose that the user was not authenticated, not privileged to access that request, then the request failed. So for that it will have to return a different type of message. So you can't just write I will take an example of traffic light. So traffic light uses red light, yellow light and green light. So red light shows that you will have to stop. Yellow light shows that the light is going to turn green soon, so be ready. And green shows that you are ready to go. So right now, why the system is like that? It should be, why can't it be like, hey, you should stop, write a sentence, or hey, you should wait, hey, you should go. So it is because that people would conceive the meaning differently if we use like English sentences or English language. But if we use symbols or like fixed codes, then the meaning is like universal. Everyone can relate to it. Everyone can understand it. So there is where status codes come into play. For success requests, we usually have 200 status code. And for error requests, we have 300, 400 or 500, like 30x, like 301, 302, 401, 402, 400 or 500 something requests. And response types is the type in which an API returns a response. Most common response type is JSON, which you can see here, but we also, some people also use XML. I don't know what's the advantage of that. And then we have like headers in API. So what are headers is that, suppose you are returning a data in an API, but the data needs to be consistent, like it should relate to the request which was asked. So headers provides additional information that should be returned with a request. One more advantage of header is that suppose the server changes in some way that it needs to provide additional data to the client. So it can attach that information to the header instead of changing the body, which is this. So the client app won't have to be updated again to actually fetch actually understand this material. So you might understand now that why API is needed. So API is like a bridge that connects the backend server to the rest of the world. If we don't have an API, then the server is like running isolated somewhere in the USA, and client apps are running everywhere, but they don't have any information. API can be used by both Android apps as well as websites. Almost everything that's not on the same computer as server will use the API to access information from the server. So API is the heart and brain of the Open Event project. Like, you know that API, Open Event is very expensive. We have app generators, we have web app generators, we have websites. So how these components all depend on a central server for the data. So API provides a way for these apps, these client apps, to access the data from the server. Little about the code base before we begin. The code base of the server part has been written in Python, Python 2, and it uses the Flask framework. Database is handled through SQL Alchemy, and migrations is managed through Alembic. Yeah, I would like to tell something about Alembic here. So why we use migrations is that suppose that one person is running the server code base, which is of 28 January. Now suppose the database was updated on 29 January, and now the person wants to run the code from 29th January. So if he runs that code again, then the code will access a non-existing field in the database which was not created on 28th January. So for that, we actually use Alembic. So Alembic will track the changes in the database, and it will create a separate file for that. So if you can patch that file to the existing database, and so the database will be updated according to the new changes. So like, you know, Git is a version control system. Alembic is a version control system for databases. So before we start beginning to develop the API, we had to choose a framework. Like, it was going to be a big project, big work, so we can't just like go blindly. We had to carefully consider how we are going to code that thing. So we thought that the API framework that we are supposed to use should be modular, should be hackable, and should allow document generation. So modular because lots of people, I remember that 6 people were working concurrently on the server project in GSOC last year. So if 6 people are working, so one can change one file and another can change another file. So we don't want conflicts. So for that, we needed a modular framework. So modular framework will allow us to develop one API in one file and another API in another file. So we had to choose a modular framework. Next, hackable. And hackable because we were making a very specific use case of the API. So we wanted to be sure that every of our needs will be covered by the framework. Like, suppose not every framework does everything. Some framework may not support authentication, some framework may not support input validation. So if that's the case, we want that the framework should allow us to hack into it and add that feature. And third was that it should provide ease of documentation generation. So 6 people working on a project every day for like 3 months, and concurrent projects like the Android app and the website was going on. So we wanted that the documentation of the API should be up to date as possible. Like, if one commit is merged to master, then the documentation should be generated quickly, so that the developers working on the client app should know what the changes are and what the changes they are supposed to do. So we needed a framework that will allow us to do this automatically. So the framework candidates were Flask API, Flask-restplus, Flask-restful. We were also thinking about using like no framework at all. Python, Flask already provides a way to interact, like handle API responses, but in that case we will have to do a lot of work manually. So Flask API was a very limited framework. We had to make a decision between Flask RESTful and Flask RESTful. So Flask RESTful is a very powerful framework, but it doesn't provide automatic documentation generation feature. Flask-restplus provides that feature, so we settled for Flask-restplus. So why didn't we choose Flask-restplus? First, it provided the ability to write modular code. So that allowed us to write, like I was doing the events API and Niranjan would do the sessions API concurrently. So that was the reason we used Flask-restplus. Sessions API was in a different file and events API was in a different Python file. And Flask-restplus allowed us to define response models clearly. Like if you want to return a response from a code, then you can just create a JSON, hard code a JSON and just return it. But that is not a good way to do, especially when you are working in a team. When 6 or 10 people are working together, you don't want that other guy to be clueless that what he has done. So with Flask-restplus, we were able to define the response models clearly, and Flask-restplus also like automatically generated a documentation. That was a big plus for us. It provided blueprints and it was hackable. Like we hacked it to add custom API request, input validation, custom error. These type of features were very important. Custom API request allowed us to add different type of requests that a server would do. And input validation allowed us to check for errors in the input data when server got that data. And then we implemented errors also. So the code base looks like this. First we have the app folder. Inside app folder we have whole of the code. API resides in the API folder. We have helpers folder, models folder for the database tables. We have static folder for static data like images or logos. We have templates folder for the HTML view, and then we have views folder for interacting with the website. So defining an API in Flask-restplus is actually very easy. First you create a namespace, then a model, then a resource, and then you attach namespace to API. I will show an example for this. So here you can see it's a working code. This code actually works and will allow you to create a server with an API running. So at first we import Flask and Flask-restplus, which is the library that we are using. We create a Flask app. We create an API for the app, and then we create a namespace. So namespace, as you can see here, we are using the string events, which means that this API will be created at /events. So suppose we wanted to create sessions API, we can use namespace course sessions description equal to sessions. So that would have created a sessions API. But for this example, I am using events, so events API. And we attach the namespace to the API here in this line. And now we create a resource. So what's a resource? Resource is actually a URL that a server, that an API works through. Resource is a URL that from where an API works through. So I have added a slash here, which means that this API will be accessible through /event/. And now I have defined two methods here, get and post. So what get means is, suppose someone sends a get request to that URL, then this message will be returned. And if someone sends a post method to that URL, then this code will run. So like this, you can define delete and you can define put here, which will be corresponding for remove operation and update operation. So these are the open event API endpoints that we have in the Open Event project. First is the Events API, which allows you to deal with events. Like suppose you want to create an event, you want to update an event, you want to delete an event, or you want to get list of events or get a singular event, you can use the Events API. Then we have a Sessions API, which will allow you to get individual sessions or add a session to an event, those type of things. Similarly, we have Tracks API, Speakers, Sponsors, Micro Locations, Login and Users. So let me talk about the Swagger documentation. So as I was already telling earlier that auto-generating the documentation was a very important factor for choosing the REST framework. So the auto-generation of the documentation was done by following the Swagger specification. So If you are using open event project and you have deployed it to your server, then you can access the docs for the API at server/api/v1. This is the URL. Suppose that EventEA is hosted on eventea.com. So if you want to access the API documentation, you can go to eventea.com/api/v1. So this is how this URL looks. This URL looks like. So here you can see the list of all the namespaces which I mentioned here. So we have the events API, sessions API, tracks, speakers, and everything. And if you click on an API here, you will see all the endpoints that are available inside that API. Like here I clicked on the tracks API and I can see get API and get the method to get list all tracks, the method to create a track, the method to list tracks in a paginated manner, means in a page-like manner, and I can see a method to delete a track when we have its ID, and we can also fetch a track if we know its ID, and we can also update a track. So if you create on one of these endpoints here, then you can see how the response value will look like. And if you click on one of the endpoints here, you can see how the response value will look like. Like suppose if I query this URL using a get request, I will get this response, which will contain the sessions inside a track, which will contain the location of the track, which will contain the color of the track and the ID of the track. Now suppose if I click on a post request here, so this shows the response that I will get and also the input that I have to send to the post as a post request. Like here you see event ID has been included in curly braces. It means that it is a variable. So you will substitute event ID with a number which is the ID of the event. So I will add the event ID here. I will add the data to be sent here. Like this is creating a track. So if I add track name, like track credentials, like track name, location, description, and add it here and click on the post button, then it will be, then a track will be created. So all of this was created from this code base. You write a simple code base like this and you will have that this website created with this dynamic website created with all the JavaScript and listing and this response models. So how does this work? So the main reason why this works is because you are following certain conventions. Like you are defining the input and output models clearly. So input model was here, wait a sec. Like here we have, this is the input model here. So I have defined the event input model, which shows me the data type that and the API should accept into it. And I have defined the output model here, which shows me the response type that the API will give out to the rest of the world. And I have defined resource and models. So let's see this code. This is the input model, the output model, and this is the resource, which is actually the API endpoint. I have defined the get method and the post method. Now when I run this code, that website will be created with the get request and the post request documentation. So Flask-restplus already provides more documentation parameters like .doc, .params, .response, and .header. For .doc, what you can do is .doc is allows you to create an ID for a API. .params allows you to add query parameters to the documentation. Like suppose you have a URL which accepts query parameters. Query parameters are those parameters like if you add a question mark and then page equal to something and x equal to something, those type of things are called query parameters. So you can specify that in the documentation as well. You can specify this response codes like 200 response code, 400, 500, and you can specify headers in the documentation as well. So API authorization, yeah, authentication. So API authentication is open event, is like very versatile. Like one of the very common methods for API authentication is called basic authentication, in which what we do is we add the username and the password to the header and we send it to the as a request. Similarly, we have the JWT in which you get a token, you will add that token to the header and send it as a request. And we can also use session based authentication in which a cookie is set set on the server and you use that. So this is a code that shows how authentication looks like. I will just skip it for now as I'm running low on time. So let's talk about an import export feature. So import export feature of the open event is what makes it truly open. So using the import export feature, what you can do is, like, you are having an event on eventea.com, and suppose you now want to host it on your own site. So you can export the event from eventea.com and you can import it back in your own site. Like that, if eventea.com even goes down or disappears from the internet, you will still have your event. So that is why import export feature is so cool. So it will allow you to have an event template, and it can allow you to give it will give you a full backup of your event, and it can allow you to archive old events. Like, you have an event from 2007 and you want to archive it, so you can use the export feature. So So what open event can do is, it will allow you to manage your event. Like, if you want to have call for speakers or tickets, you can do it with open event. You can create an app for an event, you can create a website for an event, and all of this comes for free. So that's the power of open event. No other technology like Eventbrite or meetup.com even comes close to that. So this is how the export file looks like. It contains all the data that an event has, and it is organized by folders. So we are also using, like, background tasks. Like, suppose you are supposed to send up, let me just conclude it. So actually, in last GSOC, me and Sivam Mangin, he's not here right now, but we worked on the API part of the open event project. If you want to know more about the API part, you can visit our blog links. So you can actually remember this very easily, like is.good/openeventapiblog1, is.good/openeventapiblog2. And if you have got any questions, you can ask me or you can ping me on Twitter. Thank you.